All right, hello everyone. My name is Jason Vili. I am a conservative radio talk show host and activist, and next year I'm going to be a senior at Eastern Connecticut State University. I'd just like to briefly start by thanking Turning Point USA very, very much for giving me this incredible opportunity to fly out here from Connecticut and speak to what I consider truly some of the smartest minds in the country. And I truly, truly do mean that. And so thank you to them, and also thank you very much to you guys. You guys just simply being here really, really show that you care about the future of this country. You show that you care enough to really stand up against the things that are going on in our schools, the indoctrination that happens every single day. And so it's really, really commendable that you're here learning about how you can get more involved. Because the truth of the matter is, the majority of people our age, you know, 18, 19, 20, 21 years old, are either, number one, not involved in politics at all, just simply don't care, or number two, so far left that any conservative that tries to talk some sense to them is just completely shunned, and they just are completely ignored. So we are in the minority, but thank you very, very much for being here. You truly, truly should be commended for that. Unlike our president, you'll notice that there are no teleprompters to my left or my right. And the reason for that is conservatism, I've always felt, is not something that can be read off a screen. Conservatism is not something that has a beginning, middle, and end. It's not anything that's pre-scripted. Conservatism is something that you feel. It's something that's from your core, something that you truly breathe and live. It's truly a lifestyle. And I believe that we must apply conservatism very, very boldly and very, very passionately if we are to get the future of this country back. Last April, April of 2014, I had this creative writing professor named Professor Terry. And for the entire semester, I really didn't have any problems with him. He was a nice guy. I like writing, as a little side note, so I really enjoyed going to his class, even though it was at 8 o'clock in the morning. He was a nice guy, very, very fair guy. And then one morning, towards the end of the semester, I was sitting in the back of his class, and I don't know where this guy starts going on one of the biggest anti-Republican rants that I have ever heard. He called Republicans, among other things, racist, misogynist, money-grubbing people. He said that if Republicans won the Senate in November, that colleges would start closing down. And he said all these things to a captive audience. So what I did is I sat there, I took out my cell phone, and I started recording this entire rant. And I didn't make a big deal of it. I didn't say anything to him at first. I just let him do his thing. I got the entire thing recorded. And right after that class, I went to the school library, and I emailed him. I said, "No, Professor, I was really, really disturbed by some of the things that you said in class today. I felt that it was very, very inappropriate. I myself am a conservative Republican, and I don't appreciate you calling us racist, misogynist, money-grubbing people." And he got back to me within about 10 minutes. Now, I was expecting Professor Terry to say something along the lines of, "Jason, you're absolutely right. I was over the line. I apologize. You're absolutely right." Instead, this guy emailed me back and he doubled down. And he said, "No, I was in the wrong. I was just trying to make a classroom discussion," which he was not. This was a blatant example of indoctrination. And he doubled down and said that he wasn't in the wrong. He has no reason to apologize. And right when I got that email from him, I realized that I was at war with this professor. I was going to take him to war. So I took that recording that I had of him in the class, and I sent it off to campusreform.org. And within 24 hours, this story, this recording of my professor, was all over national news. I had the opportunity to appear on Megyn Kelly and talk about the experience. The next day, I appeared on Neil Cavuto on Fox News and talked about the experience. And at the end, this professor was forced to publicly apologize. Now, these things happen all across the country. I saw this as a victory, but the truth is that these instances of liberal indoctrination go on all across the country. And I have a few headlines here that I want to read to you, news headlines regarding this liberal indoctrination that I'm speaking about. "Professor forces students to pledge they vote for Obama and Democrats." "Public school teacher makes female students Romney t-shirt, mocks female student's Romney teacher, accuses her of supporting the KKK. Students asked to compare George W. Bush to Hitler. Michigan professor says Islamophobia, right-wing Jews inspired Charleston shooting. Student allegedly threatened with failing grade for including biblical references in a group presentation. Another professor blasts whites on social media. Oklahoma freshmen to undergo mandatory diversity training. This is the kind of things that we are experiencing on our high school and college campuses all across the country. All across the country, kids are going in, many of whom do not know anything about politics. They're going in as freshmen and coming out 4 years later as liberal progressives. And it's largely in part due to this indoctrination that goes on. It's a very, very serious problem. Every single time the school bell rings, a tiny piece of conservatism dies. Every single time the door to the classroom closes, a tiny piece of our future shrinks. Our generation will be the ones to take the torch someday. We are the ones that will one day take control of this country. And I think more of us need to realize that you know, we're not going to stay young forever. We're not going to be in school forever. We're not going to be under our parents' roofs forever. We are the future of this country. And if we allow this kind of indoctrination to continue, if we allow our fellow students to become victims of this liberal propaganda that they hear in the classroom, that's going to be our future. It's going to be nothing but progressivism, social justice, and a country that doesn't embrace freedom but really shuns it. And I don't want to let that happen. Now, in addition to speaking up against these professors, we also have to go after the victims of indoctrination themselves. I remember one day, my sophomore year of college, I was talking to a kid in the dining hall, just sitting there, and we got into a little political debate. And he informed me right off the bat, that he was a straight-up communist. He was a self-described communist. And so I was kind of sitting there thinking, how can you be a communist? But anyway, we got into a little debate. We were kind of going back and forth. And I was, you know, countering him with facts as conservatives do. And he was using the whole rhetoric about how Republicans are racist and all this stuff. And the second he said Republicans are racist, that he made that the key point of the entire debate. Republicans are racist. Every single point that I would make, he said, well, Republicans are racist anyway. And I got up and I said, all right, the debate's over. I can't take this anymore. But this is truly the problem, because what we need to do also is break through these kind of stereotypes. They are out there and people are buying into them. These stereotypes that Republicans are racist, that Republicans hate women, that Republicans are rich, white, old guys. People, we think of them as completely ridiculous, but people like this kid that I debated in the dining hall are buying into them. And it's a very, very big problem, because they're not interested in debating the substance of the issue, which conservatives win time and time again. They're interested in looking at things like, are you racist? Are you sexist? Are you this? Are you that? So we need to take it upon ourselves to break through these stereotypes and challenge our peers, challenge our fellow students, to say, you know what, let's have a debate, but I challenge you to not use words like racist, like sexist, like whatever, and just debate the substance. Just debate the substance, because when we can force the left to debate just the substance, just the facts, that's when conservatives win. That's when conservatives win. Indoctrination is an issue that I am very, very passionate about. I've been dealing with it for well over 6 years now. But it's truly an issue that's different than all other political issues. It's not like immigration, it's not like gun control, it's not like the issue of the economy. Those issues are largely dominated by the politicians in Washington and the mainstream media. Though they're the ones that are debating those issues. The issue of indoctrination, liberal bias in the classroom, is our battle. It's our battle because we are the ones sitting in the classes, listening to these professors like Professor Terry, calling Republicans racist, misogynist, money-grubbing people. This is our battle because we are, like it or not, right in the middle of it every single time we walk into the classroom. It's our battle and we need to stand up. We need to stand up. Raise your hand in the middle of class. Say, Professor, that's not exactly right. If you hear a student talking after class, saying, you know, this professor was right about this, Republicans really are bad people, challenge them. Engage them in debate and tell them that no, we're not. Explain to them the truth. I truly believe that right now, among young people like you and me, we need some kind of a revolution in this country. And I'm not talking about a revolution like the year 1776. I'm truly talking about a revolution that fights back against this kind of liberal bias in the classroom. A revolution of the heart, a revolution of the mind, and a revolution of the American spirit. I'm going to be starting an organization myself in the months to come called Youth Revolt. And what it will be, briefly, is a network of young conservative radio broadcasters and columnists. And I truly believe that if we can get all of all the liberty-minded young people in this country together in one place, as we are now, in many different networks, then I think we will really, really begin to see progress in terms of fighting this kind of indoctrination. I'd like to close by reading this quote. "Freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. We didn't pass it on to our children in the bloodstream. It must be fought for, protected, and handed on for them to do the same. Or one day we will spend our sunset years telling our children and our children's children what it was once like in the United States where men were free." I really don't want us to experience the sunset years, but it will happen if we don't take a stand, and a very, very bold stand, against the kind of things that are going on in the classroom. We're losing our young people. We're losing our generation to this leftist mentality, and we need to stand and we need to fight back. Really is, it's a 501c4 organization. We have it all set to go. It's really making progress. And what it would be specifically is a radio network, basically, an online radio network of kids, young people like you and me across the country who want to speak out either in the format of a radio program that they do once or twice a week, or columns on the website, you know, articles or something. But the idea is, number one, to get all these liberty-minded kids together. And number two, to give them a really, really a good platform for speaking out against this. You know, writing articles, I think, is great. I think it's a great thing. But I think that radio and, you know, podcasting in general, for that matter, really allows kids to be vocal about it, to, you know, raise their voice and show their passion. So that's kind of the idea behind MusicVault, and I think it's going to be really something good. Yep?
What do you suggest we should respond when, say, a teacher does do that, and we raise our hand or whatever, and we start talking, say, "I think you're wrong," or whatever the case may be, and they say, "That's irrelevant," or "Be quiet, I'll take off my participation," something like that?
That's a risk that you have to take. It's a very, very real risk, and it's honestly something that I took into consideration when I called out my professor. There's always the threat that they're going to, you know, take off points for participation or hurt your grade in some way. And honestly, I think those are real threats, they're credible threats, but for me personally, those kind of things don't deter me, and I don't think they should deter anyone in this room, because the way I see it, if a professor is indoctrinating your class, and then you call them out on it, and then they follow up by threatening to give you a bad grade for it, well, then you have a right to, you know, do something like that, take it to the media, take the fight to the next level. That's just the way I see it. It's a very, very credible threat. It's a very, very real threat. But the way I see it, I think that fighting back against this sort of thing is more important than risking it. And listening and reading. Yep?
Would you argue that the organization would create more division, I guess, in the school, or solve the problem?
I would argue that, I think, and this is going back to the idea that we're getting all these people in one place, I think that if we were able to successfully do that, I think students that are on the left and students that aren't involved in politics at all would kind of look at it and say, okay, a lot of people are jumping on board with this sort of thing. Young people love jumping on bandwagons all the time. I think that if they saw all these liberty-minded students and young people in one place, I think that they would be willing to check it out and at least find out more about it. I don't necessarily think it would cause more division. I mean, there's always going to be, you know, the average Democrat or liberal that you know, is so far left that they're not going to come to your side. But Youth Revolt, I think, will have a wonderful opportunity to bring over people that maybe aren't involved in politics at all and give them a resource where they can learn more about liberty and what we truly stand for.